Welcome to The Curious Developer. I'm Jesper Petersen from KDAB, and we're talking about different tools for helping with AI-assisted development. We looked at Visual Studio in the previous episode, and I cut it short because I did get Jan slightly into the deep end of the pool by asking him to do stuff that he had not prepared. That's life when you record with me. Welcome to the show, Jan. It is a pleasure to see you once again.
Hi, thanks for having me for a bonus episode.
So Jan, we looked at Qt Creator, we looked at Visual Studio Code, and whichever of these two you use depends entirely on your personal preferences. It seems like I better go and check up on that Visual Studio Code myself, because that looked pretty powerful. But if you are with Qt Creator, and if you are not able to use the version that they put out, then there are alternatives. It's called QodeAssist, but with a Q, so QodeAssist, I don't know. That looked good on paper, I guess, but can you tell me a bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So this is not an extension that Qt company provides, but it's available on GitHub. And you install it by downloading the zip file that matches your platform, and then you can install it via the via the extensions, and then the install extension button. You search for the file on your disk. That would be the setup. Then maybe let me first show you the setup in the Qt Creator settings, because what I quite liked about this plugin is that it guides me through more of the setup. So I can choose different providers of LLMs. Here's a full list, and the tool is more knowledgeable about the endpoints for the different APIs and everything. It also allows me to describe the prompts and specify different prompts for different languages, as you see here. There is different setup for code completion and chat assistance. There is more settings here where you can tune individual modules in their settings. So you do have a lot more flexibility with this tool than other tools that I have seen here. And then after I've showed you the settings, let me jump into...
Well, I regret right away if I ask you what top P and top K and so on,
what all that means. Let me not go into those details, but this is parameters that you can set on the LLM models and change their behavior. Yeah. Let me also quickly jump into the provider settings bit, because you again see here that you can provide different API keys. But as I was saying, the API endpoints for those different tools, they are more directly set up so that you don't need to figure out which is the correct endpoint there. And again, because we're showing an API key here, by the time that we publish the videos, they will be revoked, just that you know. Okay, so let me show you a little bit of the interface. There is code completion available. There's the same way that we've seen with Qt AI Assistant, that it will just complete a line. What I want to focus on here in this presentation is that there is also a chat module available as a separate chat. And while this is, as far as I've seen, not yet in an agent mode, I assume there is an interest in having that here too. But so far, this is a chat that can add additional files from your code base into the context of your chat question. So you see here that this is automatically syncing with the files that I have opened, and there is a list of open files here. So when I send a request, it will add the files to the context, and then my question can refer to the files, and this allows the LLM then to give me answers that are more well suited to my code base and the specific problem that I'm trying to solve. So this chat will also, it will be more powerful than you just pasting a question into, for example, a ChatGPT web interface with a few code examples, because it more easily has included the code that you're using. And what I also found quite interesting, because Jesper, you asked me this in the first video that we recorded, or was it the second, that how many tokens am I actually using when I make requests and all such. And Here, for example, you have a token counter that gives you an indication of how large will the request be that I'm going to send. And that gives you a better idea of the cost that you can expect for the kind of queries that you make. So if you're using QCreator, you might want to give this plugin a shot. As you saw, it works the same with ChatGPT as the other plugin we looked at. It also works with other models, and it will also work with self-hosted models.
Okay. Then there is I've heard my boss is very fond of something that just is super hard to Google, Cursor. And the other one was called Windsurf, I believe. I mean, who comes up with names that is a common word that everybody has written a million times on the internet? That makes it slightly harder to Google, doesn't it? But nevertheless, Cursor and Windsurf, can you tell me a bit about what are these tools compared to everything we've seen so far?
Yeah, I cannot provide you an in-detail comparison. I didn't go through all of the tools, right? I do know Cursor a bit because this is a tool I was also playing around with. And Cursor, so maybe we go about it like this. So GitHub Copilot is an extension that you add to Visual Studio Code. You have your normal Visual Studio Code experience, and GitHub Copilot is an additional thing that you have in there. And Cursor tries to be an IDE that is built around LLMs and around interaction with LLMs. So this concept of an agent mode, they had as one of the key features from when I started to use them. I have also heard from colleagues that have been trying these out in more detail. Now that GitHub Copilot has this agent mode, the differentiation between those IDE, the Cursor and, for example, GitHub Copilot has reduced a bit. Again, this is not something I have tested in detail. My general advice would be that many of these IDEs have a free mode for a trial. So it makes sense that you try out IDEs that fit for your use case and have the right toolchain support and see which of the different IDEs works well for the use case that you have and for the way that you want to interact with the LLMs. That also goes in the direction to say that GitHub Copilot is available as a plugin for many different IDEs. I, for example, most of the time I use JetBrains IDEs, like specifically Sea Lion. And GitHub Copilot is also available as a plugin for Sea Lion. At the moment, while we are recording, this agent mode has not made it into the Sea Lion plugin yet. And I'm hoping that it will be added soon.
So one of the, if I may just add my own observations, that is with Visual Studio Code, similar to Qt Creator, the first thing you're asked is like, get me a key here and do this there and so on. And it will take you half a day to figure out all the settings that it wants before you can just make the first completion. But that's at least one of those things when I tried Cursor out that was very interesting to me, that yes, it came with a cost, but it also came with the models built in, already set up. So I downloaded Cursor and voila, I was off the ground. And it was a Visual Studio Code clone in any case. So for those who knows that IDE, it's not too foreign.
Yeah, let me add to that when you use Visual Studio Code with GitHub Copilot, you do need to log into your GitHub account, but you do not need to paste authentication tokens to the different model providers, right? Because GitHub Copilot will access them directly. You just need to log into GitHub. And that the same with Cursor, you log into one account and then you have access to the different LLMs and to the different modes that are available in the IDEs and plugins. And the setup in QCreator is quite more cumbersome when you need to search API endpoints and you need to search for API tokens.
Yeah. Okay. This is your last and final chance to tell us anything on this in this mini series. Otherwise, well.
Yeah, I think I want to add this point that in this space, there is a lot moving, right? You have a lot of new models coming out every now and then. The large companies try to place their models also very publicly. And then there is like a lot of discussion, is this model in that direction better than in the other? And then there is a lot of tools growing around LLMs. There is new standards growing. The space is moving fast. And I found it worthwhile to every now and then check what is the current state of what's going on and play with different models, play with different tools, and see which ones work for what you're trying to do. And my experience is that people have very different ways to interact with the tools. whether they ask for information, whether they ask for changes to something that is already there. And I think I like to see them as an additional tool that I have in my toolbox that is very different to work with than other tools that I have, but I'm not going to concentrate on only this one thing. I'm trying to keep a diverse toolbox around.
What you're really doing there is try to convince me to have you back on the Curious Developer in a year for a catch up, what has changed episode. I can sell it, and you're welcome. I would like to see you in a year again.
I will say I did not have that in mind, but I would be very happy to show up again when there is new things to show. Yeah.
So one thing on the way out of the door here with you, I'm wondering, it's super difficult to predict the future and so on, but I'm just wondering on a very specific use case that I've been waiting for 25 years or so. I mean, when I was a very young man, younger than I am now at least, I was promised that in the near future, our IDEs would be able to do refactoring. And there was this refactoring book that everybody had a copy of, and I can't even remember who's the name of the authors anymore, but it had a very detailed catalog of refactorings and everything from pull method into superclass and push method down into subclasses and all of these things. And I've been waiting and waiting and waiting. And I can, if I'm lucky, then I can jump from definition to implementation in my IDEs. But all these super fancy refactorings is still not, at least in the world of C++, very common. Is that something that you see changing with the help of AI in the near future, or should I wait another 25 years?
So the way that I'm reading the refactorings that you were talking about, they were, let's say, algorithmically clear changes of a code base that would be perfect in the sense that because you can pass the AST and you have a certain pattern that you're changing, that after the refactoring operation, your code would look different, but it would compile, it would pass tests, you would just have changed structure. And I have my doubts, but we will see how this plays out, right? But my understanding or my model of how the world currently changes is that we will not be there with LLMs that they do this perfect, logically reasoned and perfectly step-by-step, perfectly drawn refactoring. What I do think they will do is, if you have a refactoring in mind that you want to apply and you describe it well enough, most of the refactoring work will be done for you. And then you go through the changes as we've been seeing in the past episode and verify the changes, overlook some of the issues, spot some of the issues and fix them. And you have like a tool that amplifies your coding abilities. This is something I see, and this is something I have also done quite a few times now in my daily development. I assume that these tools will get better and better over time, because I think we're currently only scratching the surface of how you can interact between LLMs and already existing tools. I do not think there will be the perfect solution that will do all of this perfectly. This is kind of a notion that is included in these questions. Like, will it replace this whole refactoring process? And I don't think that will happen. That said, I can't predict the future, so this is my best understanding of what's currently happening. And everything that happens differently than I expect will make me a lot more curious about how is it different from what I thought would be happening. So I'm very interested in seeing what's going to be around in a few months or years.
Okay. Thank you very much for participating in the Curious Developer over these past, what's going to be, 8 episodes now? Something like that. In the next episode, I will talk to my boss. Very unexpected, he was one of the very first movers in KDAB when it came to, Khalid, not unexpected. You are a bright man and a good colleague, and oh man, is my nose brown already? But he has definitely been looking into AI-driven development, and he has been playing around with it in languages that he is not that familiar with. He's very well established knowledge inside of general purpose software development, but tried it with languages that he's not familiar with. And that journey he'll describe to me in tomorrow for your timeline and even for my timeline. I'll talk to him tomorrow episode. So until then, have a great time. And goodbye, Ian.
Goodbye.